Good afternoon, everybody. I welcome you all to this third session of JLU Knowledge Web Series organized by JLU. And this is particularly the School of Law, interacting on various topics. First of all, quickly, I would like to introduce Jawaharlal Nehru Lake City University to our audience. Jawaharlal Nehru Lake City University was established in 2013, and it has just completed 7 glorious years of academic excellence. JLU offers undergraduate, postgraduate, and research programs in diverse fields. It is one of the most awarded universities of Central India. Currently, JLU is offering 56 degree programs to more than 2,500 students from 8 countries across the world and 27 states of India. The university has 27 academic and industrial partnerships with top industries and international universities, ensuring that our students get not only national but international exposure of the best kind. The university has been best with several prestigious awards, such as University of the Year by the Government of Madhya Pradesh for consecutive 4 years in 2015, 16, 17, and 18. It is also recognized as a Global League institution in 2015 at the House of Commons, London, UK. JLU Bhopal has been ranked as number one private university in Madhya Pradesh in the years 2016, 17, 18, and 19 by several leading publications. With this, I would like to go ahead and introduce our panelists for today, Advocate Sushil Solanki, sir. He's a retired senior bureaucrat who has worked in the Excise and Customs Department for more than 30 years. He's a chartered accountant by profession. He was one of the team members who drafted service tax law in 1994. Further, his eminence can be judged from the fact that he was a part of Government of India's team for formulation of policies for introduction of GST in India for almost 8 years. For his distinguished services, he was conferred with the prestigious Presidential Award in the year 2001. He is a regular faculty in Training Academy of the Customs and GST Department, and he has also trained officers from Tax Department of various SAR countries. During his tenure in the government, he was directly involved in bringing lots of changes in the functioning of government department by way of introduction of professional system of audit, simplification of various procedures, and removing anomalies by way of legislative changes. His book, Guide to Central Excise Audit and Study of Financial Records, is also a part of curriculum for IRS officers training. Presently, Sushil Solanki sir is working as a partner in TLC Legal Mumbai, a firm dealing exclusively in indirect taxes. Further, in order to ensure time efficiency, I would like to request our audience to type in their questions as the session progresses so that the same can be put in front of our esteemed panelists during the Q&A round. Now, without any further ado, I would like to hand over the session to Advocate Sushil Solanki, sir, who is going to illuminate us on the constitutional and legal perspectives of GST. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Ankit, for a very lovely introduction. First of all, I'm thankful to the JLU for giving this opportunity to talk to all the young students. Good afternoon to all of you. Today, I'm going to take the session on the goods and service tax, which has been implemented from 1st July 2017 in India. What is the background? And even a short span of 2 years, some matters have reached the Supreme Court also. So you can understand the legal implication of this particular law. So let me start with the seminar. What are topics what I'm going to cover? Are the evolution of GST, how it has evolved over the last 3 decades. And second is why the GST, what were the need for introduction of GST in India? Basically, what were the inefficiencies were there in the erstwhile indirect tax regime, which has led to the introduction of GST? Next, the salient features of the GST. Then for the purpose of introduction of GST, what are the constitutional amendments have been introduced that we will discuss this. And as I was referring to you, there's a judgment of Mohit Mineral Private Limited in 2018, which is pronounced by the Supreme Court, and very important issues regarding the power of the union government to levy the cess was challenging this judgment. So we'll go through this judgment, which can be of very much interest to all the law students as to how the constitution has been interpreted. And the point what I can take up is whether the parliament or the state can impose any cess in addition to GST. then what are the different challenges we can have under repeal and saving provisions under GST law? This is the last one, is a very interesting and a common topic, which most of you as a legal professional, whenever you start your practice, you will face this particular provisions in almost every new law. So let us discuss that repeal and saving. At the end, we will take question and answers. Let us start with the evolution of GST now. Being a law student, I must say that let us start with what are the provisions available in the Constitution regarding the taxation matters. Most of you must have read Article 260, which says that no tax can be levied without the authority of the law. So this is the base, or you can say the mother provision in the Constitution, which makes it mandatory that no tax can be levied unless a particular law has been made. And on this article itself, there's 100 to the Supreme Court, whether any particular law, any procedure, any instructions given for levy and collection of taxes, whether it satisfies the requirement of Article 265 or not. Then comes the Article 246. This, I think, almost every one of you will be aware that in the federal setup like India, the power to legislate has been given in the three listed in Schedule 7 in the Constitution. And Article 246 mentioned that who has got power to legislate on a particular subject. Like List 1, all the subjects mentioned in the List 1, Union, that's a parliament, has been empowered to legislate. List 2, where the state legislature has been given the power to legislate. And the List 3 is a concurrent list where both parliament and the state legislature can make the law. This will be relevant because certain changes have been made with respect to this Article 246, which we will deal with when we come to constitutional provisions. Now come to that GST, that's a goods and service tax, that's an indirect tax, and I think all of you must be knowing. Indirect tax is a tax where the incidence of burden is borne by the final consumer. It's ultimately the final consumer who buy the goods for his consumption, or he take the service for his consumption, he is the person he ultimately bear the burden. So in that context, what are the entries in List 1 and 2 regarding the indirect taxes? I've just tried to put it here. Union excise duty is in the List 2, entry number 84. Then there was a power of levy of service tax. Entry 92C was introduced, but it was never notified. But the service tax levy, which has come in 1994 only, was always under the regulatory power of entry number 97. Then the next entry is 92A. That's for the CST, Central Sales Tax. That is regarding taxes on movement of goods from one state to another state. So that levy is governed by 92A. Then there was power to levy cesses. The regulatory power under 97, under that List 1, which is given very clearly that if any subject has not been mentioned in the List 2 or List 3, including any taxation power, then the union has got right to levy or make the law for that. There's another entry for levy of customs duty on import and export of goods, that was entry number 83. Why I mentioned in the end that this particular levy has not been got merged or subsumed in the GST. This we will see a little later on. Now come to List 2 now. List 2, where the taxes and powers, the most important was the entry 54. It was there, now it has been deleted. That was regarding taxes on sale and purchase of the goods. Then another important entry was luxury and entertainment taxes, entry number 62. Then taxes on the entry of the goods in a particular territory, known as the entry tax or the outright tax, that was under entry 52. Electricity tax or excise duty on liquor was also part of List 2. I'm just giving a reference. We will discuss in detail when we go to the, you know, part of GST, what has happened there. Now come to 1994 now. why it is important, but because in 1994, the service tax was introduced first time in the country. I had the good honor to say that I was one of the person who drafted service tax law in 1994, when I was working in the Ministry of Finance, and Dr. Manmohan Singh was the finance minister at that time. So even though the economy's total GDP out of that, around 50% was contributed by the services, there was no tax on the services. Therefore, based on the recommendation of Raja Chalaiya committee, the service tax was introduced in 1994. This is an important happening in the taxation history in country. Then comes the 2003 to 2008. That time what happened, all the states had levied the sales taxes, but many of the states were not allowing the set off of the tax paid at the one stage when the goods were sold to the second person. Like A sells the goods to B and B sells to C. In that case, if the tax sales tax was paid by A and again sales tax was liable to be paid by B, then the taxes paid by A was not allowed to get set off at the stage of B. And therefore, a lot of distortions have come in the taxation structure. Therefore, on the basis of certain recommendations, VAT, that is a value added tax, was introduced in the various states from 2003 to 2008. Then 2005, a KILCA committee was set up, and that is recommended for introduction of GST in the country. Constitutional amendments, bills were put up in 2011 and 2014, but ultimately the constitutional amendment was carried out in September 2016, and from 1st July 2017 we have the GST now. Now let us, as a student of law, it's always better to know when a new tax or any new law is introduced, what was the reason behind that. If we know the reasons, in that case we can appreciate the various provisions, and even while arguing the cases before the courts, it's become necessary for us to explain to the court, and that strengthen our arguments also, that why this particular levy or particular law has been introduced. With that respect, let me give the reasons why the GST was introduced. It means there was something was not puri tanki, something was not all good in the old regime. So what were the problems in the erstwhile indirect tax regimes? First and foremost was the multiplicity of taxes on same transactions. As I was mentioning in the constitutional power, let's take example on same goods. Suppose a Maruti is manufacturing the car in Gurgaon. When they manufacture the car, they were paying central excise duty. When it was sold from, say, Gurgaon to Delhi, they were paying the central sales tax. Then there could be some octroi, there could be some entry tax. Then the goods were sold that were again pay the sales tax or value added tax. Some of the states had turnover tax, consignment tax. Like in the same transaction, say of purchase and sale of the car, there would be a number of taxes, and taxes imposed by various different authorities. So that was really creating a havoc for a person to deal with. Then you have multiple and complex compliances, like say for the sales taxes. Even if the Maruti, in our example, was selling the cars through, say, all the states in the country, then every state have their own sales tax law or the VAT law. So there would be maybe 30 laws they were supposed to know and 30 compliances. That was really becoming a nightmare for the people to do the business. Then for it, next is varying tax rate for same item in different states. Say for the same example of Maruti, a particular model of car may be taxed at 18% in, suppose, state A. It can be 28% in state B also. So people could, you know, opt for certain evasion of taxes or avoidance of taxes by doing the arbitrage in purchase and sales. Then the problem of tax on tax was there. And then ultimately the leakage of revenue. Because the multiplicity of taxes, there were no one department of the government was not talking to second department. So person could declare something to one department, they will declare something to other department. So here a lot of leakages were happening. So this was the basic background under which the introduction of GST was thought necessary. Now let us see what the whether GST has been introduced and what are the basic features of the GST law. First is that GST has been introduced on all goods and services except 5 petroleum products. I mean, in India, on supply of any goods or any service, there would be GST. There would be levy of goods and service tax, except the 5 petroleum products, which are crude, petrol, diesel, natural gas, and aviation turbine fuel. Except these 5 products, or any of the goods, if it is supplied in the country or the services, there will be GST. Second, the most important part is the subjugation of almost all central and tax state level indirect taxes. Now, you have central excise duty, you have the service tax, you have the state VAT, you have the luxury tax, entertainment tax, which we pay when we go for seeing the movie, luxury tax when there's many of the hotels and restaurants levy it there around, octroi, entry tax. You have more than 25 to 30 cesses. Cess means there can be rubber cess, there can be higher education cess, there can be a health cess, there can be an industry cess, there can be a beery cess, there was rubber cess. So many cesses were there. Now, almost every such, all these taxes have been subsumed in the GST. Now, all the old taxes are nowhere. A person is required to pay only the GST. Okay. Another important point is that on one transaction, there would be the two GSTs, one is central GST and another is state GST. Central GST, short form is CGST, and state GST is SGST. Now, somebody can ask the question that why there are two GST? There could have been the one GST, and at the back end, the tax amount could have been the, you know, shared by the state and center. I fully appreciate the point. And this was the view of many of the economists in the country that when you are introducing GST, let's have a one GST. Why should we bother the taxpayer for him to pay different GST? But you know, India is a federal country, and with the experiences in the past, whenever there was dealing between the state and central government, actually, no one trusts anybody. There have been bitter experience in the past where state government says that whatever the taxes or the financial aids were due to them have not been given to them by the center. Maybe because of different political parties were there, or because of some financial problems or all that. So states have made up and told very clearly while formulating the GST that we want our GST separately, because money should come to our coffer so we can run our business, we can run the state. Otherwise, every time we have to, you know, bank upon a bag before the central government that please pay our money, pay our money. So in this federal structure, there was no option left but to bring the two GST, one is central GST and the state GST. But a very important aspect is that the law for central GST and law for all the state GST around the 30 states is the same, it's similar. The rules are same, the forms are same, everything's same. So this is the best part of the GST now. So you have the two GST, whenever you sell the goods or supply the, you know, goods or services within the same state. But if suppose you are supplying the goods or services from one state to another state, then you pay only one GST, that is known as IGST. Full form is integrated GST. And it will be the total of both the GST rate. For example, on one item, the central GST is 9%, state GST is also 9%. The same goods sold from one state to another state, there will be the integrated GST of 18%. I'm not going in much detail because that is not relevant for today's discussion now. GST to be levied at all points of sale from manufacturer to consumer, right from first stage from manufacturer till the last stage when the goods reaches to the consumer, GST would be levied. I already mentioned same law for central GST and same law for state GST. So next is interstate sale. This is a very important point now. Whenever there is a goods are sold, suppose there is one dealer or one businessman in Mumbai and he's selling the goods to another businessman, is say in Ahmedabad. So in that case, a tax called IGST, integrated GST, will be paid. And that integrated GST paid by the Maharashtra businessman would be available as credit to the buyer in Gujarat state, that's in Ahmedabad. That's a very important change that we'll discuss in detail. And movements of goods through e-way bill, electronic way bill, for every movement of the goods, mostly for the longer distances, the electronic way bill through the net is generated. That's mostly for the purpose of tackling the evasion. Now let's come to from the R point of view. For bringing the GST, what were the constitutional changes were made there? And those constitutional changes were made through 101st Amendment Act 2016. Let's see the important one. There's a new article that's known as Article 246A that had been introduced. Let's say what is the clause one says, notwithstanding anything contained in Article 246 and 254, Parliament and subject to clause two, the legislature of every state have power to make laws with respect to goods and service tax imposed by the union or by such state. I'll just stop it here, but that's very important. It means by through a new article, power to levy GST or to make the law with respect to the levy and collection of GST, the power has been given to the central government and to the state government. This is a very important change. How it is an important change, we will take up a little later. Clause 2 says, Parliament has exclusive power to make laws with respect to goods and service tax, where the supply of goods or of services or both take place in the course of interstate trade or commerce. So whenever the goods are sold from a party in one state to party in another state, there will be levy of what I explained to you, integrated GST, and that will be levied by the central government, by the parliament. And whatever the money is collected by the parliament, that will be also be subject to distribution. The money does not remain with parliament. And the explanation and clause 5 I'm not dealing with, I'm not discussing. We'll just go to the next important amendment. What is the definition of GST? The Article 366, which is with regard to definitions given in the Constitution. It says the goods and service tax means any tax on supply of goods or services or both, except the tax on supply of the alcoholic liquor for human consumption. So it would be a tax which would be levied on supply of goods or supply of service or supply of both goods and services. What is the meaning of supply? That has been defined in the GST law. But what is goods and what is service has been defined in the Constitution. However, the GST will not be applicable on the supply of the alcoholic liquor for human consumption, because power to levy excise duty on alcoholic liquor still continue to remain with the states. Now, this is a very important thing. I think the first time in the history of this country, such an innovative, you know, ideation has takes place. I'll tell you, when we were discussing about introduction of GST in the country, there was an empowered committee had been set up. That empowered committee has the representative of central government as well as all the state governments. So there was always a, you know, discussions that in the case of GST, how the power would be utilized. What is the guarantee that central government doesn't usurp the power, or the state governments makes a gang and suppose tomorrow decides something at the central government? How to take care of this? And how to ensure that the decisions regarding the GST, various decisions, whether to tax a particular item, whether to exempt it, what should be the procedure, you know, so many things were there. Who is going to decide? So in this connection, a concept of what they call GST Council, Goods and Service Tax Council, was formulated. And this council has been given the entire power for, you know, all various acts regarding the GST. So for this purpose, this article 279A has been introduced. I can tell you this particular article is going to be litigated before the courts, up to the highest court, for various reasons, and we'll discuss it again now. Now, what this article says, the article 279A provides for constituting a council called the Goods and Service Tax Council, what we call GST Council, and who will member Union Finance Minister as the chairperson, then all the representative of the state governments. So it will be, representation will be given to each state. So all will become part of the GST Council. Now, what this council will do? The council can make recommendations on the following. So council will make the recommendations regarding which taxes or cessages to be subsumed, the goods and services that are to be subjected or to be exempted from GST, which goods and what rate the GST to be levied, what exemption to be given, this particular body will recommend it. Then the model GST law, again, this body will recommend. Threshold limit of turnover, say in the case of goods now it is 40 lakhs, in the case of is 20 lakhs in a year. This has also been recommended by the GST Council. Recommendations will be made by the council. Very important. There is a clause in this particular article which says that while discharging its function, the GST Council shall be guided by the need for a harmonized structure of GST and for development of a harmonized national market for the goods and services. So the entire objective and the purpose, or you can say the goal for which the GST Council will function, has been given in this particular clause. Now, this clause, in my view, it will be very, very crucial whenever the courts decide the cases, as to decide whether the GST Council, whenever there is going to be conflict, how to resolve the conflict, and suppose the matter comes up before any authority, then those guiding principles, aim of the GST Council is to develop the national market, is to ensure there is a harmonization of system, would be kept in mind while deciding the cases. Now, other important changes, I'm just skipping it now. Okay. Okay, Article 270, which is existing, it says that how the taxes collected by the central government shall be distributed. And important thing is that this talks about taxes and surcharges, which shall be distributed between the union government and the central government. But there is an amendment that has been made, which says that how this GST should be apportioned or the surcharges should be apportioned. That's also been given there. Now, Article 271, it says the Parliament has been provided with the power to levy surcharge for any of the tax and duties levied by it. What is the amendment has been made there? That in the case of GST, goods and service tax, the power to impose surcharge would not be there. So the parliament don't have the power to impose surcharge on the GST. Now, this is another important clause in the Constitutional Amendment Act. And what does it say? That the parliament shall by law, on the recommendation of the GST Council, provide for compensation to the states for loss of revenue arising on account of implementation of GST for a period of 5 years. Because when the GST introduction was going on, it was a continuous demand by the state that how do we ensure that after introduction of GST, our revenues are secured. So because we are all, you know, entering into uncharted territory, we don't know how much collection is going to be there or not to be there. So they wanted some sort of a guarantee by the central government, and central government through the constitutional amendment provided that yes, we will compensate to you for the next 5 years at the rate of 14% growth every year. That of course rate of 14% has been agreed through this separate law. Now let's come to the important point now. Till now what we discussed, how this GST has evolved, what are salient features of GST, what are the constitutional amendment. Now let's see the analysis of constitutional amendment, which will be very important to all of you as a law students now. What are the important aspects once, you know, notice in this constitutional amendment? You know, first time I find that a concurrent accession power has been given to the central government, the state government for the same transaction. Till now, the taxation power on a particular activity was given either to the center or to the state. There is no concept of giving a concurrent taxation power to both the central government and the state government. This is the first time this deviation has been made. And this was necessary in order to bring, you know, subject all the taxes, various types of taxes. And we must give a lot of credits to our politicians in this country, which we otherwise keep, you know, blaming and keep criticizing. The first time I realized that all the politicians, anyway, they have given up their power. Otherwise, taxation power is a very big power to tax a particular activity, particular item, to give exemption, give a relaxation. That entire power was available to the central government, the state government, with respect to the specific taxes what they were empowered to levy and collect. With this introduction of GST now, the entire power has almost gone to GST Council and is not concentrated in any of the one state or even with the center. So this is the time both central government and state government in a way has given up their power, and this is really a great achievement for this country. So first important thing. Second is that the first time taxation power are devolved by specific article rather than adding to the subjects of list in one and list one and two. As I have mentioned, excise duty or service tax or, you know, similar customs duty, everything were given the list one, or the sales taxes or luxury taxes were given in the list two. Now, first time the taxation powers are not being operated through any of the list, but for which a separate specific article had been introduced in the law. And this become that article 246A, just now what we refer to. This will be very important because a lot of questions will arise about the interpretation of this article 246A, under which the, you know, this I'll just show it once again now. This 46A. So under this, the power had been given to the union government or to the, you can say, parliament and to the state legislature to levy the taxes of the GST. So this power to levy taxes has been brought to a specific article through the, not through the list. This is another, a novel way of drafting of the constitution. What it will have the implication, we will see when we come to particular judgment now. Third is most important, delicate balance of power in federal system and which has been attempted through mechanism GST Council and forward to adjudicate any dispute has been assigned to GST Council itself and not to any judicial form. Now, as we know, India is a federal country. India is following a federal system of the governance, where both the central government and the state governments have their power in their respective field now. Now, when we brought the GST, now the whole question of balancing came, the who will have got what power. And this balancing act has been done through the introduction of GST Council. And you know, the initial when the Constitutional Amendment Bill was introduced in 2011, that time there was a proposal that if there is a dispute between the central government and the state government, who would decide? The first 2011 Constitutional Bill has mentioned that there will be a judicial body who will decide this thing. Then a lot of deliberation took place, and it was decided that it is not good to refer the matter to the or give the entire form to the judicial forum. So therefore, they have kept this dispute resolution where the dispute may arise between the center and the state, between the two state, or maybe between two state and the center. The entire power to decide upon those has been kept with the GST Council, and GST Council can decide their own mechanism. They can decide through their own members. They can take the help of the renowned judges. They can take help of the economists also. They can make a body also consisting of economists and politicians and judicial people. They can do anything. So entire power has been kept with them. This is another very novel idea which has been created. Because I know when we were drafting, I was at the initial stage, I was part of drafting of the Constitution Amendment. I'm not an authority by any means, but yes, I got chance to work for amendments. So a whole lot of issues were coming to our mind, how to, you know, ensure that this particular law or amendment means are acceptable to both the central government and state government. A whole lot of, you know, things were going on. And then was thought about, and this provision was brought, that this was refined, and ultimately the final shape in which it's come. Now, at last, GST Council decisions are recommendatory in nature as to provide independence to the legislature. You know, when we were deliberating on this amendments, then the whole questions come that on the one side, there is a GST Council, which is a body of the politicians. And that second side, there are the will of the people, which is operated through the parliament or the state legislature. So who is superior now? Is the GST Council is superior, or the parliament or state legislature superior? So a whole lot of debate took place. Ultimately, a viability was found out where it says the GST Council will make the recommendations, and it is for the state and central government to act upon those recommendations. Now the question here is that if there is a dispute arises, the GST Council recommends something, and a particular state does not do it, does not accept that recommendation, did not act upon that recommendation, what will happen? In that case, the role of GST Council will come into picture, and they will devolve or evolve a mechanism how to tackle that situation where this recommendation of GST Councils are not accepted. So in future, because now it's a very short period has taken place, has happened, in future those problems may arise now. Now let's see now, you will be surprised that in a short span of, I will say about July 17th, July 18th, in less than a year, the matter regarding the GST law and the implication of the constitutional amendment has reached the Supreme Court. What happened in this case? This levy called GST Compensation to States Act is for the purpose of giving the compensation to the states. A new levy called GST compensation to states CESS, CESS, has been introduced. And whatever the collection is made through that particular CESS, it is used for giving compensation to the states for shortfall in revenue, if any, as agreed by the central government. This particular levy had been imposed by the parliament, that's for central government, levied by parliament, collected by central government, distributed to the states. The rules have been framed. In the case of Mohit Minhas, it was challenged that this particular GST compensation to states says is ultra vires of constitution. Very interesting arguments came forward. What were the arguments put up by the appellant before the High Court? An interesting Delhi, Honorable Delhi High Court, in the interim order say, yes, there is a prima facie case that this particular levy is ultra vires of constitution. Because there is no power in the constitution to levy the particular cess. Let us see what were the argument put forth by the appellant. The first argument is that the GST has been introduced with the Solomon objective. And one of the objectives is that we should do with the multiple levies, multiple cess, multiple surcharge, and all should get subsumed in the GST. And therefore, if you bring a new cess in addition to GST, the object of bringing the GST, the object of objective of the, you know, making amendment in the constitution is completely diluted, but this amendment is repugnant to the provisions of the Constitutional Amendment Act. The second argument was that it's a colorable device. This particular law or levy is a colorable device which doesn't get any support or any power to levy the same under the Constitution. The third argument is that there is a provision to give compensation to the states in the Constitution, but there is no provision, there is no power for the parliament to levy this particular cess. These were three of the important arguments put forth by the appellant. Now, what the Honorable Supreme Court has held, let us see that. It says that, first let me come to the final decision, so then you can appreciate the point. The Honorable Court has held that the levy of this particular cess or compensation cess is intra vires. It's within the competence of Parliament. It's within the constitutional amendment provisions. And therefore, the petition was dismissed. Now, what were the grounds taken? Those are important from us to understand. The first ground taken by the Honorable Supreme Court was that Article 246A, which is a newly introduced article, which empowers the parliament and states to make the law in respect of goods and service tax. So it says that this particular article provides that parliament is empowered to make law with respect to goods and service tax imposed by the union. And if it is same is imposed by the states, they also got the power. They say that when there's a specific power to impose the GST, there cannot be any bar to impose the cess, which is also a tax in nature. What the Supreme Court has held, that cess is nothing but a tax. So what is this? Let me take the first next slide, you'll understand it. It says the cess is also a tax, which is levied for a specific purpose. Now this issue that whether cess is a tax or not has been litigated in many cases, and many cases have reached up to the Supreme Court. Because if it is not a tax, then whether it's levied by the parliament or by state legislature was provided as per the constitutional provision or not, this was challenged in many cases, different types of cess. So ultimately, the Supreme Court has held that cess is nothing but is a particular, is another name for the tax. But yes, cess is levied for a particular purpose, say for example, health cess. So that cess is levied for the purpose of improving the health infrastructure in the country, and it can be used only for that purpose. So the cess collected will not go to the Consolidated Fund of India, which is used for a general all type of expenditure by the government, but the cess will go in a particular account, a particular fund, which will be used for a particular purpose. So with this background, a lot of discussion about cess is a tax has been made in this Mohit Minerals case relating to GST Compensation Act. So what the Apex Court says that cess is a tax. So if there is a power to make law with respect to GST, goods and service tax, then there is a cess which is in relation to GST, power is available to the union government or the parliament. Secondly, the court says the word used with respect to make laws with respect to GST, with respect to is a phrase which has also been interpreted in number of judgments with respect to the constitution, with respect to the taxation law, with respect to the other law. I still remember in the case of central excise law, in the service tax law, it has been income tax law, it has been, I mean, debated number of times. And the general concession that with respect to is a phrase which is expansive in nature, which expand the scope, is not something like reducing the scope, it's expansive in nature. Therefore, in the parliament has got the power to make the law with respect to GST. So it can not only GST, anything, any other tax which in the nature of GST, and GST is what? As I mentioned to you, what is GST? GST is the tax on supply of goods and services. Any tax on supply of goods or services or both is the goods and service tax. Now, in that context, any tax which is tax on the nature of supply of goods and services would be get covered by 246A. And this compensation cess is nothing but a tax. Therefore, Parliament has got power to levy it now. Secondly, it says the Article 270 provides for distribution of cess. So Article 270 provides that if any tax or surcharge or cess has been collected by the union, then it should be distributed. So when there is a provision for distribution, it implies that there is a provision for levy thereof. This is the reverse argument or reverse analogy has been drawn by the Supreme Court. It says that when there is a power to distribute, so unless you collect it, you can't distribute it. So indirectly, the power to levy also comes. At the end, the last argument which had been taken by the Honorable Court is that Clause 18 of the Constitutional Amendment Act provides for payment of compensation to states as per law, and that law includes law for imposition of cess. As I mentioned, the appellant has taken the plea that there is a provision in the Constitutional Amendment Act that the parliament would be required to pay compensation to the states But that does not give the power to you to make the law for levy of any such compensation. But here the court said no. Again, because this, as per the constitution, parliament or union government is required to pay compensation to make as per law. And that law includes law for levy of compensation, not only for payment of compensation. I have a little different view on this. B.R. Ambedkar, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, Honorable, in the Constituent Assembly, once he mentioned that, I am bound by the law of the courts, law of the Supreme Court, but I'm not bound to respect it. There can be difference of opinion. I may have a difference of opinion in clause 8 in this interpretation, because when this clause, if you read it, it gives a very clear meaning that here there's only responsibility cast on the union government or the parliament that you should pay for the compensation to the states for 5 years. And that compensation you will pay by vow, by making a law, how should you pay it, what, how much to pay it, when to pay, everything thereon. But drawing the power to levy under this clause appears to be a little far-fetched. But anyway, Honorable Apex Court has taken, so we'll go by this also. So you will realize that within a span of less than 1 year, the matter has reached to the Apex Courts, challenge the constitutional aspects of the amendments now. Now let's see the next now. So the question here is that, yes, this is a two more argument which was taken by, not by appellant, I'm sorry, this by the plaintiff from the government side, that Article 248 specifically provides that other than the subjects covered by list 2 and list 3, parliament has got the full right to levy or to legislate on those subjects. And even until 97 in the list 1, there's a residual power. Parliament, as the central government, has got power to levy. And this, under this, both the provisions also, even if they are not governed by Article 246A, the power emanate from Article 247 and even until 97 in the list 1 to levy the compensation cess. So these were the argument taken by the, on the behalf of the government. Of course, the court did not pass any, you know, given their view on this, but I feel there's a two good arguments for also there. So the question here was that what we discussed was the power of parliament to levy the cess. The second question comes whether the states has got power to levy cess. In my view, it's very clear in view of Boeing Minerals Supreme Court judgment, because there the Supreme Court has held that Article 246A has got the power, and Article 246A empowers not only to union government or to the parliament, but also to state legislature. So naturally, state government has also got power to impose any cess, and under this power, Kerala has already imposed Kerala flood cess. I just want to mention one thing that Article 279A, which is a newly introduced article, which empowers GST Council to GST Council for various activity, and one of this area where GST Council can recommend that the special rates to take care of natural calamity or disasters. So under the constitution, the power has been given that GST Council can recommend imposition of a special rate on any goods or services to take care of natural calamity or disaster. So under that provision also, this Kerala Flood Cess Act could have been imposed. So that is what on my state's power to, you know, impose cess under the constitution. Now, this interesting aspect now, just coming it now. If you see the question here is that the goods and service tax definition, we saw that it means that tax on supply of goods or services or both. The words goods has already been defined in the Constitution. It covers that all the material things, substances, etc., etc., etc. It defines the services. Very interesting aspect. Just have a look now. The Constitution defines the service means anything other than goods. Article 366, Clause 26A. Does it mean that under the GST, the Parliament and the state has got power to levy the GST on anything, any transaction, any type of transaction? The relevant question is that if the taxing power had been assigned in the states to the states, say through the list two, whether under Article 246A, the Parliament can impose tax on that particular activity. Let me give example now. Entry 50 of list 2 says taxes on mineral rights. This is the power given to the states to make the law, impose the taxes, and collect. The question here that under Article 246A, Parliament had been empowered to levy a tax called GST on supply of goods and services. Can the Parliament take the plea the service means anything other than goods? So taxes on mineral rights is nothing but taxes on the other than goods. So it is a service. So I got a power. Can the Parliament also take the plea that I got a specific power under 246A? Your power is coming through the list two. So perhaps my power is more superior than yours. My understanding would be that the answer to this will be that no. Parliament not and should not venture into the areas where there's specific rights have been given, specific power had been given, specific subjects have been included in the list two or list three. Otherwise, it will be, you know, the whole differences will get blurred. In that case, all types of taxes which are left over in list two, the central government will say, I got power under 246A and I will impose taxes. My answer would be no.
Sir, if I may, sir, if I may interrupt, due to paucity of time, I would like to request you to wrap the session because we have also question and answer session.
Okay, I just give me 5 minutes. I'm just ending it. Okay, thank you. Last portion, since time is coming up, I will just take it now. Like any law, when the GST law was introduced, that's called central GST law or state GST law, there are always a repeal and saving provisions are there. And what does a repeal and saving provisions? It says that whenever the, because it is repealing the old law, so certain X under the old law has to be saved. So what is 173(4) of the CGST Act inter alia provides that any liability or obligation accrued, acquired or incurred under the old law cannot be extinguished without a specific provision. Similarly, any benefit accrued, acquired or incurred under the old law cannot be withdrawn without specific provision. Now, what is repeals and saving? Because as a law student, you will find in any of the new law, which is introduced by repealing the old law, you will always find those provisions. And General Clauses Act also had the repeal and saving provisions. Even if the law does not have them, the provision of General Clauses Act would be applicable. So this is the one area where a whole lot of disputes will go. Because there were a couple of benefits were available in the erstwhile Central Excise Law or the VAT Law or the Service Tax Law. And those benefits have suddenly been, you know, withdrawn without any specific provision for their withdrawal. So those cases are bound to be litigated. Matters have gone to the court. number of matters. We say, for example, one person that under central excise or the service tax law, I was allowed to take credits for the taxes paid by me on this particular activity. And those taxes I have paid after introduction of GST, because those assessments were completed after introduction of GST, I cannot get the benefit now. So the question here is that, in my view, the repeal and saving provisions will come into picture, because that benefit had accrued or it is acquired by the person, by the taxpayer under the old law. And unless there is a specific provision to withdraw that benefits, the SSC will continue to get the benefits. There are a number of such, you know, issues up there which will happen. And the time is short. I'm just stopping it here. And we'll take the, you know, question and answer. I'm just showing the slide because there's one book written for the, you know, GST for the layman. And I have reviewed this book. If anyone is interested, you can have a look at this book also now. So I think we can go for the question answer now, there is anything.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for that highly enlightening session on GST. You have touched upon very important topics, important dimensions of GST. I have received a couple of questions from the audience. I have some questions which will make it more effective. Sir, first of all, the question that I have received is, sir, there is no express mention of tobacco products covered within or without the purview of GST. So what will be the position of... Sir, since there is no express mention, there is an express mention of alcoholic liquor for the... Hello, sir, am I audible? Hello.
Yeah, now it is okay. Now it is okay. Tell me now.
Hello.
This specific mention of alcoholic liquor is there?
Sir, is there, but there is no specific mention of tobacco products or petroleum. So what is the position of these products? Because the government stance is that these are also outside the purview of GST. Tobacco products and petroleum.
I'm just coming to both the question. Regarding the petroleum products, the list one of the Schedule 7, where the power has been retained with the central government for levy of excise duty on manufacture of petroleum products, as well as entry 54 in Schedule 2 on all the five petroleum products, what I mentioned in my presentation, this is crude, petrol, diesel, aviation turbine fuel, and natural gas. There the power continue to levy the respective old taxes with the central and state governments. Now, as far as tobacco is concerned, tobacco is part of the GST, but at the same time, the power to levy excise duty has been continued with the central government. So tobacco is part of the tourism now. So there will be a GST on tobacco products, and there will be the power for the central government to levy the excise duty. The reason I will tell you why, because in the GST, the levy of GST is generally capped, say 18% of it, some says something extra. There is a whole lot of extra revenue was coming to the central government. So in order to take care of some revenue requirement, power to levy excise duty has been continued on the tobacco products. So it is in the GST. At the same time, the power to continue to, you know, levy excise duty with central government has continued there.
Okay. So excise duty continues on tobacco products. Sir, there is one more question. If there is a decision given by or recommendation made by the GST Council, and if a particular state is not adhering to such decision or recommendation, what is the situation then? If a state is not adhering to the recommendation of GST Council?
I think it's a very good question, and I try to cover it up some part of it. See, in the days to come, this whoever is raised the question also, is likely to come. Especially when there is a different political, you know, parties are there in center and state government. And sometimes even with the same political party, there may be the local compulsions. See, for example, I tell you now, suppose there's one particular item called Agarbatti, which is manufactured mostly, say, for example, in Karnataka now. Because of various political reasons, for employment reason or for political constituency or something, Karnataka say we want to give little extra benefit to this, you know, industry, agarbatti industry, for example. Now, whereas all other states have nothing to do, they say no, we don't want to give the benefit. The GST Council decide no, we will impose 18% tax on that. Now, so Karnataka, because of political compulsions, they say no, I will not, you know, I don't want to impose this 18%. And suppose they don't follow the 18%, now what will happen now? Because even though Karnataka is part of the GST Council, but in the GST Council, the decisions are taken by majority. Okay, so majority, the Karnataka government may not have mustered the majority. So what will happen? In that situation, this Article 279A and their clause 11, it is given very clearly that GST Council will establish its own mechanism to adjudicate any dispute. The dispute will include the non-following of the GST Council decision. So in that case, GST Council will evolve their own mechanism. Now they may make a committee of 4 or 5, you know, ministers, and then they decide, okay, can we impose any additional financial burden on Karnataka? You know, by giving the compensation to Karnataka, we will reduce the compensation, etc., etc. So this mechanism of power given to GST Council itself to take care of such, it will take, you know, it will solve this problem.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Just one last question before we wrap up this session. Sir, there are several GST rates for several classes of products, and various businesses are engaged in either manufacturing or supplying those products. So is there any possibility that businessmen can play a fraud on the government, or they can pocket unreasonable or undue benefit from finding a loopholes in GST mechanism or GST rates for several products? Is there a possibility businessmen frauding or defrauding the government?
See, the frauding can be done with any type of law, any type of strict law. But the chances or probability of fraud has reduced in the GST, basically for the first reason that now there is only one type of tax, one type of law is there only. Earlier, we have excise duty, we have a state VAT, you have central sales tax, you have octroi, you have entry tax, you have so many other taxes. So different taxes, he can declare something to one department, another department, and by this way, there were chance of, you know, evading the taxes could have been possible now. But with the one law, and the most important thing in the GST, there's something called GST network. Here, almost everything is digitized. All your transaction, even invoice-wise transaction, whenever goods I'm selling as a dealer, and where my buyer is also further selling it, each and every of my invoice is fed in the system. So there is a full lot of, you know, tracking is possible, audit trail is possible. And because of that audit trail, the number of cases have been booked in the last 2 years, especially about what they call the bogus bills or the fraudulent bills, you know, where the only the documents have passed without movement of goods. These things were happening in the past also, but it's have been easily been tracked in the GST because the GST system track each and every transaction. So I will say the fraud cannot be eliminated in any system because ultimately it's a ingenuousness of the human mind, basically. But yes, considering the structure of the GST and the GSTN system, the probability of frauds detection is much higher in the GST.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for such an enlightening session. I think we are done with the time. I hope our participants and attendees have really enjoyed and got themselves aware of the various dimensions and intricacies of this particular law, GST. It has been in a contentious point for 3 or 4 years now. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us.
Thank you very much for giving opportunity, and thanks everybody, dear, and anybody